Welcome to Think Tank, the podcast. I'm Steve Adubato. We're coming to you from East Main Media Studios in beautiful Little Falls, New Jersey. I'm joined in studio by my good friend and colleague, Jeanette Hoffman, Republican strategist and president of Marathon Public Affairs, and also can be seen on New Jersey Now every weekend on My9.
Correct.
And also Chasing News, which is on Fox 5 and My9.
Right. Fox 5 New York at 1 a.m. for all you insomniacs, and My9 New Jersey at 11 p.m.
You do the 1 o'clock a.m. show live? No, I'm joking.
No.
And by the way,
I do have a life.
And by the way, speaking of your life, because it is relevant to the program we're about to do, the segment that we're about to do with Dr. Dafna Lemish, who is a distinguished professor at the School of Communication and Information at Rutgers University, where I got my doctorate. I just want to disclose that.
This is relevant. Dr. Adubato, should we refer to you?
Yeah, no, not at all. But this is important because we're going to be talking about some research that Dr. Lemish has done on children's television in the United States and Canada. You care about children's television because?
I have 4 kids.
Ages?
So I have 2 teenagers, 15 and 13, and then I have 2 toddlers, 2.5 and 1.5.
We're doing a lot on work-life balance. How's that working
for you?
It's... out of balance?
It's a little out of balance right now, but that's okay. It'll sync up at some point.
Well, we're only in balance here...
when I'm 80.
Yeah, right. Watch this corny segue. We're in balance here at Think Tank, the podcast, because of our underwriters. I want to thank our friends at Johnson & Johnson, the Russell Berry Foundation, the Terrell Fund, and our initiative, Right From The Start NJ. Actually, go on our website, Right From The Start NJ. It's all about taking care of, finding childcare for infants and toddlers, and also Horizon Blue Cross and Blue Shield. Let's set this up.
All right.
So Dr. Lemish, who is a distinguished professor at the School of Communication and Information at Rutgers, has done this extensive research on children's television in the U.S. and Canada. Mm-hmm. And she talks about the lack of diversity. She talks about how women are often viewed in weaker positions than men, and a whole range of other issues. The main characters in children's television, disproportionately male. The LGBTQ representation does not exist.
Yeah.
Most characters are white, 65%. When faced with a problem, males are logical. Females use magic?
Magic.
What?
I know.
Come on, that had to bother
you. It's so funny.
It bothers me too.
It did. It bothered me. And a lot of this shocked me, honestly, Steve, because, you know, like
the findings in research?
Yes. I kind of pay attention to what my kids watch, right? So the babies, PBS exclusively, because PBS, I think, is the gold standard for children's television. I'm going to say it right now. Sesame Street, does it get any better for diversity?
50-year anniversary to our friends at Sesame Street. Go ahead.
Right? I mean, especially when you talk about socioeconomics, they portray every different... I mean, you see, the doctor talked about the different wealth gaps that, you know, it's really just, she said, most children's television portrays upper to middle class kids. But I think Sesame Street is different. You see a whole range of different socioeconomic backgrounds there.
As well as, we actually did a special on this, Sesame Street has a character who actually
Julia.
You're ahead of me.
Yeah, she has autism.
Right. Now, who does that?
Sesame Street does that.
But
that's
there's not enough of that diversity,
exactly,
according to Dr. Lemish. And obviously, just we know that.
Right. So, Steve, that's why I was shocked by this study, because my little ones primarily watch Sesame Street. So I didn't realize children's television is that bad, right? So I guess it's cable TV that really needs to get with it and stop portraying girls, especially, as using magic to solve problems, and boys as just, you know, being smart and rational and using logic. It's really... we're going into 2020 to have that kind of a disparity. It's very unfortunate to me.
Well, Jeanette, by the way, Jeanette Hoffman in the studio here with us. This is Think Tank, the podcast. But I want to break this down. What do you believe, as we're about to listen to Dr. Lemish from the School of Communication and Information at Rutgers University, what do you think, and by the way, men dominate leadership roles in children's television. What do you think the long-term ramifications and implications of this preponderance of television programming that just... is very skewed?
I guess it's kind of like everything, right? I mean, we need to do better in society and promoting women in leadership roles. It's like anything. It's like, you know, that's what the Girl Scouts do. We need these more opportunities for girls to see themselves in leadership roles. And children's television obviously needs to do better. And I think it's a really important study.
It shapes, by the way, when you were a kid.
Yeah.
Do you remember what, my wife often says she loved the Brady Bunch.
Love the Brady Bunch.
You're a big Brady Bunch?
Brady Bunch, Little House on the Prairie. I'm old school.
Hold on. That was Michael Landon?
Michael Landon, yeah.
What did you like about that show?
I really don't know. It was just, probably I didn't have many choices on what was on TV.
It was nothing like my family. I just want to say that.
Little House on the Prairie?
Nothing.
I like Laura Ingalls Wilder.
You're a screwed up house in Newark.
But Yeah. But you know, there's a female role model for you. She was the star.
Who was
Laura Ingalls Wilder?
Is that right?
And she wrote all the books, right? And I read the books as well. So there's a female role model for you in children's television.
And by the way, the other piece of this on diversity is interesting because, again, disproportionately, the characters are white, upper middle class.
Well, that's not a surprise.
Yeah, it's not at all. But Dr. Dafna Lemish is a distinguished professor at the School of Communication and Information at Rutgers University, my alma mater. Again, I want to thank the folks at the Terrell Fund right from the start, and Jay, the Russell Berry Foundation, Johnson & Johnson, Horizon Blue Cross and Blue Shield. I want to thank our good friend Jeanette Hoffman, who joins us here in the studio. We're about to listen to Dr. Lemish, break it down. First, we're going to hear a PSA. Then we're going to listen to Dr. Lemish on Think Tank, the podcast. Thank you, Jeanette.
Thanks, Steve.
Check it out.
I work for Horizon Blue Cross Blue Shield, and I'm a catastrophic case manager. I'm a nurse. I feel a sense of responsibility to each and every member that I speak with on the phone. I know where they live, I know their towns, I know the hospitals they go to. A lot of times I know their physicians, and I love helping people at very difficult times of their lives. The job I have now is the perfect job for me. I think I was born a nurse.
Welcome to One-on-One. I'm Steve Adubato. This is our guest. She is Dr. Dafna Lemish, who is a distinguished professor at the School of Communication, Information, and Information at Rutgers University, which I know very well.
Yes, you do. You're a graduate of our program. We're very proud of that.
I will disclose that. I barely got out. Let's do this. Take a look at this headline from our friends at the Star-Ledger. But this was reported in a lot of newspapers. What's on TV for kids? Not much diversity, and that is exactly what we're here to talk about. Doctor, you and your colleagues did a study.
Yep.
Children's television in the U.S. and in Canada, and you found some alarming things, particularly around the lack of diversity. Make the case.
Well, first of all, just to clarify, it's not just U.S. and Canada. It was an international study. U.S. and Canada was just part of it. So the issue we're talking about is global, international. Well, what we found was still the television screens that our children are exposed to are dominated by white males from middle class. So, enabled, that's another really important point to emphasize, that you don't see any children with any kind of disability or any kind of health issues. So what we find is that you have a minority of females, which is still amazing, you know, 10 years ago.
A minority of females in this day and
age?
Yes,
which is amazing because we did a similar study 10 years ago, and we were sure that now, 10 years later, we'll find, you know, equality with everything that we've been discussing about gender equality in the last 10 years.
Sure.
So it moved up from females being 32% of all the characters on children's television to 38%. So we have a little progress, but if we wait for this pace of progress, it's going to take another 25 years to get to 50%.
And how are girls portrayed versus boys in a lot of this programming, so in terms of their power, their ability to get things done?
So that's a really important question, because it's not only the number, it's also how they're portrayed. So we know the females, for example, tend to be more followers rather than leaders. They tend to be in groups rather than be loners. The boys are more loners. They're kind of the top of the pyramid. They're, you know, they compete.
Are boys seen more as leaders?
Boys are more
thinkers.
Leaders. Three times as leaders. Also, boys solve problems using STEM. They use technology, they're using science, they're using math, they're using engineering.
And girls?
Magic.
Magic?
Magic, you know. Remember the fairy with the fairy?
Yes.
So girls use their magic, their charms, their sexuality, whatever it is, to solve problems, while boys use skills and they use talent and they use rationale. So those are all very old-fashioned kind of traditional stereotypes.
Excuse me, if you're just listening to us on the audio side, this is Dr. Dafna Lemish from Rutgers University, did an important study internationally on this. So what message does it send to girls as they watch this? By the way, we have an 8-year-old girl, daughter, who watches, and I'm really concerned.
You know, if you're not represented, if you don't see yourself, whether you're a girl, whether you're a person with disabilities, whether you're a minority person, when you don't see yourself, you imagine that all the exciting adventures, all the talented things, all the falling in love, all the good things that are happening to children are happening to white boys. And what about me? If I'm not represented, what does it tell me about my value in society? We keep saying that television is a school. It's an alternative school. It teaches our children about life. It is about what's valued in our society. It teaches about what it means to be a boy, what it means to be a girl, what's good, what's bad.
It socializes them. It's supposed to reflect society. And what about children who are, frankly, not very rich?
Well, they're not
Were they represented?
They're not represented because most of the stories are about middle class or middle and higher class children. And that's really a problem because we're not talking about representing poverty. I mean, we're not talking about campaigns for, you know, with children starving in Africa with mosquitoes all over them. We're talking about children who are from different life circumstances and still can be happy, can be talented, can be resilient, can be capable, can have, you know, good life. So you don't have to be middle class, you don't have to be rich to have a full, meaningful life.
We're taping this program in Newark, New Jersey at NJTV. You don't see a lot of kids from urban communities like Newark? Is that what
no,
you're saying?
No, we don't. We don't see minorities.
So what are they looking at? So,
well,
so kids
looking,
in Newark, Jersey City, Camden, Philadelphia, New York City, the Bronx, Brooklyn, what do they see?
They look at white middle-class society and they think this is what life is and should be.
And where do they fit in?
They don't fit. And the interesting thing about it is, as I said before, this study has been done internationally. And because most of television that travels around the world is produced in the United States and other Western countries, so children around the world are watching American television. So you could be, for example, you can be in Ghana where 95% of the population is black, is African, and you still see a society that is white.
What about who's behind the scenes making this children's programming? What does that reflect?
That's very relevant because what we found in the study is that the majority of the people creating this content are males. So you have, especially in the directors.
Shocking.
Well,
I'm joking.
I know.
So they, what do they make stuff about themselves or what,
they
the way
bring,
they see themselves?
You know, they bring their perspective. They bring their life experience. Right. And that's what they know. And that's what they think is normal. We also found.
Talk about the value of diversity in the workplace. Go ahead.
Yeah,
I'm sorry.
So it's mainly the creators and the directors that are males, but also the writers and producers. You see a little bit more of mixed teams, like you have females and males together, but very few teams that are led by women. So it's still dominated by males. And the other important point is that most of the television for children is fiction television. Out of it, most of the programs is animation. In animation, the profession of animation is highly dominated by males, and they produce whatever they believe, you know, is their life experience.
Listen, I don't want to turn this into a commercial for public broadcasting for PBS, but PBS was examined here.
Mm-hmm.
And we've done a lot of collaborating with the Children's Television Network, the folks who make Sesame Street happen. And I know that Julia is a character on Sesame Street who has autism.
Yes, I think Down syndrome or autism?
Well, she has autism.
Autism, okay.
And we've talked about this extensively.
Okay, my mistake.
Was PBS in any way different in children's programming?
Yes, PBS was different. PBS has a higher percentage of women in the workforce and also a better presentation and representation of females. For example, many of the female characters on television in PBS are leaders, rather than followers, which is a very different result than from the other stations. And it's not, you know, when we talk about PBS, everybody talks about Sesame Street, which of course, you know, is a flagship
a lot
of education.
More than that.
But it's a lot more. There's so many other programs that are being produced now that consider girls, that consider diversity. In terms of diversity, of race diversity, you see better representation in PBS than commercial television.
The LGBTQ
so it makes
them, community?
Oh, they don't exist?
They don't?
They don't exist in children's television. Yes, they don't exist in children's television, just like, you know, poor children don't exist and children with disabilities don't exist. They don't exist. It's a in
but they exist.
Well, of course they exist. But
they exist
children's
in
television,
large numbers,
in children's television, it's taboo. We just had a big scandal of... Yeah, we just had a big scandal about this recently in a program that did present some kind of a mixed marriage, one-sex, you know, same-sex marriage.
And that was controversial?
And that was a hugely controversial in children's television.
We watch Modern Family with our children, and I'm thinking to myself, that's a commercial,
well,
that's not even public broadcasting.
Children's television is quite conservative in that regard and in other areas as well.
So that's adult programming I'm referring to with Modern Family. Children's programming, what is it, draw a line and say we're not talking about this?
That's absolutely true. In one of my studies, I interviewed producers, and that was their argument, that they do not show at all, do not touch this topic because it's taboo, and they're going to get terrible you know, responses to that.
We have just a minute or so left. Dr. Lemish, from distinguished professor from Rutgers University, from the program that I was proud to graduate from. I'm going to ask you something before you leave. What are we supposed to do now? Now that you've done this study, what are we supposed to do?
Well, I'll tell you what we do. First thing is, like you said, you graduate from our program, is that we educate and train the next generation of people in the media to be aware of issue of race, of diversity, and all kinds of human demographics and human characteristics. And we hope that they will be leading a different kind of screen in the future. That's one direction. programs like this, you know, raise awareness of the public that this is an issue.
Just talking about it, exposing it.
Talking about it and selectively watching programs that do show diversity and not watching programs that don't. I mean, we know this industry is based on ratings, and if you just don't watch programs that you think are not representing your world and not representing the values you believe in, you don't watch them. And if you don't watch them, there's power there.
Final comment on our end. I appreciate what you said about ratings, but in public broadcasting, we are blessed to be able to do programming that makes a difference.
Absolutely.
We would love to have more people watching, but ratings do not drive what we do.
We're
fortunate enough to raise the money to make it happen.
Dr. Dafna
Lemish, distinguished professor at a great program. It is the School of Communication Information at the State University, Rutgers University. I want to thank you for joining us.
Thank you very much.
Hi, I'm Cecilia Zalkin. It costs much more to care for an infant than for an older child, and many New Jersey child care centers don't have the funding they need. Because of this, many children in New Jersey don't have their basic needs met. Right from the start, NJ is dedicated to supporting this vulnerable population, children from birth to age 3. We know that the early years are the most critical, and we believe that every child deserves a bright beginning and a healthy future.
One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been a production of the Caucus Educational Corporation, celebrating over 30 years of broadcast excellence. Funding for this edition of One-on-One with Steve Adubato has been provided by the Healthcare Foundation of New Jersey, RWJ Barnabas Health, TD Bank, Horizon Blue Cross Blue Shield of New Jersey, the Turrell Fund, supporting Right From the Start NJ, the Russell Berry Foundation, and by Johnson & Johnson. Promotional support provided by NJ Biz and by the New Jersey Business and Industry Association. Transportation provided by Airbrook Limousine, serving the metropolitan New York, New Jersey area.